You're listening to the audio production of Ephesians Audio Bible Studies by Derwin Gray, published by Harper Christian Resources. The Audio Bible Studies series provides a unique audio learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, Ephesians includes high-quality live audio sessions from the author that cover important Bible-based topics. These sessions will reflect the ambience of the unique recording locations, immersing the listener into the teaching. While not required for the audio experience, these studies are designed to partner with the coordinating study guide, sold separately.
I'm Dr. Derwin L. Gray, co-founder and lead elder pastor of Transformation Church, and I want to welcome you to 40 days through the book of Ephesians. I'm looking forward to journeying with you. We're going to journey back 2,000 years and look into the world of the Apostle Paul and how God used this gospel, which is a bigger, more beautiful, richer understanding than we can realize. Not only will it transform our lives, but we will become a conduit of God's transformation. You ready? Let's go. The Apostle Paul visited Ephesus in his second missionary journey. It was a city that was filled with idolatry. There were temples to various Roman gods all over the place. And there's the Apostle Paul planting the flag of Jesus's cross, that the God that so loves the world has come in the person of Jesus Christ, not only forgive sins, but to create this new family that lives in the grace and mercy of God, to show the world this is what love and life with God looks like. So Paul is writing to the churches in Ephesus from a prison cell in Rome. The Apostle Paul was there and helped build these brand new upstart multi-ethnic churches. And the problem was this, is that Jews and Gentiles were having a difficult time getting along, which is very understandable. When you look at the history of Jewish people and Gentile people in the first century, you gotta keep this in mind. For Jewish people, they viewed Gentiles from this historical perspective. For 400 years, they were slaves in Egypt through Gentiles. And then the Canaanites, Hittites, and Zebubites, and Perizzites, and probably ants did bite. They were Gentiles. They tried to destroy the Jewish people. And then when the Jewish people did get to the Promised Land, because of their disobedience, another Gentile power, the Babylonians, carried them into captivity. And then now in the Promised Land and throughout the Greco-Roman world, the Roman power structure suppressed and oppressed the Jewish people. And so therefore, the tensions were already heightened and resurrection power was required for Jews to love those who had mistreated them so badly, but also for Gentiles. Gentiles knew that a Jewish attitude for the most part towards them was, you're immoral, you're unclean, therefore we can't even be around you. And so what the gospel did is it broke down these demonic powers and began to build them up into the people of God that loved each other for the glory of God. In AD 58, the Apostle Paul was under Roman imprisonment. But what was he doing? One of the things that he was doing is he was penning a letter. Scholars call it a circular letter because it was written to various churches in what we know as Ephesus or modern day Turkey. And he was writing specifically to these young, impressionable Jesus communities called ecclesias or churches. And what was unique about these churches, which was unparalleled in the first century, second temple Jewish world, that was occupied by Greco-Roman supremacy was this, is that these young churches were multi-ethnic. They were transcultural. They were socioeconomically diverse. They had Jews in them and they had Gentiles. And by the way, a Gentile is everybody else except for Jews. Now, they would have known that the Apostle Paul had this thing about getting in trouble, and so they would have figured that he probably was in prison, because we know from Acts chapter 21, 28 and 29 that he had been arrested for bringing a gonim, a Gentile, into the Jewish temple. The Apostle Paul could not help himself. He was always getting in trouble. Why? Well, we get to understand the why when we peer into the heart of God manifested through the Apostle Paul and his ministry and the writing of this incredible, beautiful book. So in the first century, in Paul's world, it was even more racially divided than our 21st century. Let's never forget that racism misses the mark. God's mark, God's goal, the word sin means to miss the mark. God's goal is for humanity to love each other as expressed through the person of Jesus Christ. It is a sacrificial love. It is a giving love. It is an affirming love. It is an inclusive love. It's a love that looks like the cross. It's a love that looks like the empty tomb. And so the Apostle Paul, in this racially divided world, gave his life for this revolutionary idea that the precious blood of Jesus not only forgives sins, but creates a family with different colored skins. And his family is a family of oneness. Well, let me give you an illustration. So as you can tell from my physique, I don't eat a lot of salads, but I do from time to time. So I want to give you an illustration that oftentimes we, as human beings, we kind of like to hang out with people who are like us. And so we kind of got lettuce churches, you know, where lettuce likes to hang out. And then you got pepper churches where pepper likes to hang out. And you have onion churches, and you know, and then you got bacon bit churches. Those are definitely Gentile churches. And then you got tomato churches. And then you got corn churches. Now, all of these ingredients are pretty good, but if you start doing this, get a little bit of lettuce. Hold on, let me get a little bit of lettuce, a little bit more lettuce, and you put some lettuce in, and then you get some of these colorful peppers. Oh my gosh, and the onions. You can't praise the Lord for some good onions. They're strong too. You put the onions in there. You need some strong personalities. And then you need some tomatoes. Let's just skyhook those in there like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Put those in there. And you gotta get some corn. Yep, corn is good for you. Put that in there. And my goodness, you cannot forget about some bacon, right? You just gotta just put it on there. And before you know it, you go, oh my gosh. And then you gotta get some dressing, because what dressing does is it puts all the flavors and it makes all the flavors come out. And so lettuce by itself is good, corn by itself is good, onions by itself is good, tomatoes by itself is good, but when you put it all together and you mix it up, you have this salad. Well, what God wants to do is he wants to create this salad bowl family where all the flavors and all the textures in Christ have been redeemed. And this is what happens. And this is what was happening in Paul's day, and this is what happens in our day, is that when we stay isolated with just the sameness, we stay in stuckness. And just like a multifaceted diamond, every time you shape it, you get a different glimpse of its beauty. Well, Jesus's church, when you bring all of God's people together in Christ, it's our differences that makes us different for the better. So Paul, in the book of Ephesians, is reminding Jews and Gentiles, he's reminding you and me, regardless of what your ethnicity is, that we have been reconciled vertically to God. The word reconciliation means this, that we were divorced and now we're remarried. It means we were separated, but now we're together. Jews and Gentiles have been reconciled vertically to God and horizontally to each other through the redemptive work of King Jesus. That we are now, the people in Ephesus, the Jews and Gentiles, and us in Christ now, that they are now the single multi-ethnic family that God promised Abraham. Friends, this is massive. In Genesis 11, God's family scatters. In Genesis 12, God tells Abraham, through you, I'm gonna give you a family, and it's gonna be like all the stars. It's gonna be this big old family made up of all the families or ethnic groups on earth. As a matter of fact, Ephesians 3:4 says this, by reading this, you're able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ. What is the mystery of Christ? This was not made known to the people in other generations, as it is now revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. The Gentiles are co-heirs, members of the same body. Now watch this, partners in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. What's the promise? The promise is this: God told Abraham, I'm gonna give you a family, and this is the family that God has always wanted. You see, the cross is bigger than just individual forgiveness. As great as that is, God is saying, I'm getting my family back. God is a promise keeper. He's a covenant fulfiller, that when Jesus came, he was God's guarantee that he's gonna fulfill his promise. Think about this. Because you're in Christ, regardless of your ethnicity, not only are you forgiven and reconciled, you are the very promise that God promised Abraham. So how does God in Christ take enemies and make them family? How does he do it? Well, because God creates this new multi-ethnic family, we are blessed. Check this out. So the Father chose us from above. Let's look at Ephesians chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. Blessed is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who's blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavens in Christ. If you're in Christ, you are blessed in Christ. Well, what is the blessing? Paul tells us, I'm so glad you asked. He says this, for he chose us in him before the foundation of the world to be what? Holy and blameless in love before him. Let's pause here. In the first century, Second Temple Jewish world of Jesus and Paul, the idea of chosenness or election.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.